becoming another MRACs in the future. The other thing as well, if you have in your park equipment or an attraction which you don't use, you close it because you don't have an operator available or there's some repair maintenance stuff and you don't use it for 60 days, you need to have an inspection done as well. That's a DAC requirement. It's very important. Sometimes you have in a park, you know, whatever for reason, equipment or attractions sitting, standing, waiting for use, and suddenly you invest a couple of thousand dirhams and get the thing going, you need to have an inspection. If this thing wasn't in place or wasn't working 60 days, after 60 days, you have to ask for an inspection to get this in public use. So these are, let's say, on top regulations to international standards here in Dubai. Unfortunately, I cannot tell really details how this is in Abu Dhabi, but I expect probably in the future for the UAE would it make sense to have a strain mild system in place. But currently, different situations. Inspection interval is usually 12 months. So those are additional DAC 16 requirements besides EN and ASTM standards for documentations and let's say inspection bodies to check during independent thorough inspection, which means we would have to see NDT certificates, we would have to see the NOC certificate and the documentation from previous inspections. Those are on top regulations which got implemented here in Dubai to have the highest possible safety level and inspection level implemented. Furthermore, as it is, the list is unfortunately not the end. Furthermore, we have a couple of more items. We need to see really definition where your stuff is placed in this slide, what the description is, the scope of the stuff, what does he has to do, where is he placed in this slide. We need to see the passenger evacuation route, we need to see emergency stops, but this is all what we do besides our documentation. We would like to see manufacturer's recommendation for the maintenance, for NDD tests. We would like to see, as I stressed out already, staff training plans and the periodic training plans. This is a very important topic. We would like to see fire protection equipment. We would like to see first aid equipment. This is just a little floor of how you should, or an example of how a risk assessment should look like for an amusement ride. I don't want to go with risk assessment, I just want to show you this to give yourself an idea what you should work on if you go home in your park and review your own documentation, your own paperwork, to really determine, okay, I have here a missing part, I have here a missing part, I should at least do my risk assessments, I should have my training maintenance records available. This could be a chart of how a risk assessment can look like for each ride and for your whole entity. So, and really important is as well, if your manufacturer is not really in charge and responsible for maintaining the ride. So essentially, when you buy the ride, you have a warranty, and then you have outlined maintenance requirements. You should have outlined maintenance requirements. And the first day in your park, when you open the ride to the public, it's your responsibility to fulfill and by maintenance requirements which you got from your supplier. And they will always try, in case of any issues, any incidents, they always try first to blame the operator owner of operational issues. So also, it's important for you guys prepare yourself and have this really in place to have good maintenance records in place to counteract in case of issues or incidents occur, that you can show I did my applications according to your instructions. That's why it's important to have the documentation from your supplier available in order to fulfill all those requirements, and then to show in a case of any incidents, I did everything as outlined and as required. Because somebody will always be responsible in any case. We can help you. We do evaluation of operations procedures, and we do evaluations of training procedures as well. First of all, the topic is on your shoulders. I think you should really get into it, get home and say, okay, what do I have in place? Do I have really good on-site operational procedures in place? Do I have my training records in place? What can I do to improve this? And if you have any questions, feel free to get back to us. So operational maintenance is essentially a three-step approach. It's first of all, please review your operations and your maintenance procedures. Do on-site evaluations. Go really out and say, how does it work? Does it make sense what we do at this site? Does the guy who is in charge of this ride or this part of the ride do really the job as outlined in this specification? Is our evacuation route, does the evacuation route make sense? Nevertheless, we had an evaluation from a third party. Nevertheless, you should always go out in your field and have an evaluation of your operational procedure on an ongoing basis. Nothing is written in stone. Lots of things changes. You have different, as I said, you have changing stuff very often in amusement parks. And some people take it serious, some people take it not so serious. That's why it's up to you and your responsibility really to enforce those topics. And it's important to have procedures in place which work, as it doesn't make sense to provide, you know, to write 10 pages of procedures. Nobody would read this anyway, and your staff in the field would read it anyway. It makes sense to really go in, go into operational procedure and say, does my guy in the field really understand this, what I did right here? Or can he even understand this? Is he able to read this and to really get the right procedures in his daily life going? It's not just about good documentation and preparing good paperwork. It's about as well to prepare the right paperwork and to have understandable procedures in place, because you don't have always everywhere on each ride an engineer. There's a lifeguard, there's somebody who has a high school or sometimes not a high school, and they need to understand the procedures. It needs to be understandable for people who are not, let's say, educated with a technical background. Yeah, this is actually an interesting thing, right? Also, it's accidents and incidents in amusement parks are often triggered by misbehavior of your guests. Of course, your guest doesn't do what he's supposed to do. But essentially, this is not an excuse, because you have to have procedures in place which prevent the guest to do such things, to misbehave. You will always have to deal with people who don't follow really the instruction, who don't take the signs for granted, who just, you know, it depends on the age as well. Nevertheless, the one who causes the trouble is not only responsible, the guy who didn't prevent the trouble is in the same boat. And that's we all. We as an inspection body, you as an operator, we're on the same boat. If trouble occurs, we are 50% in it. Doesn't matter who is really causing it. Right? And we want to avoid trouble, because this is why we are here. We want to have a safe ride and we have a fun experience. So please take this part which is around this whole independent inspection cycle, an important cycle as documentation, take this seriously, because this is a very, very important liability part for you as well. So important is really to go out in the field, you have your operations manual in place, you have your in training records or your training material in place, you have your training program in place to go out in the field and have supervise those things and assess those things on a regular basis. Because sometimes, you know, you have a highly educated engineer sitting in a desk and writing awesome procedures. And sometimes this is an engineering issue as well, right? You have to sometimes, there are sitting people in the engineering department, the engineer has awesome right, but to install this right is a nightmare because they didn't put enough place for bolts and tools in place. And this is the same as operational procedures. Operational procedures can be written in a nice office environment, but it needs to be assessed and checked in the field whether it works or it makes sense. And so, guys, to bother you with such a dry topic here, because after a meal, it's always a nightmare to sit in a training room and have to hear about paperwork and documentation and operational procedures. It's a little bit hard for you guys. So after the lunch break, but it's an important task, and it makes your whole operational task by implementing. And you have to implement this anyway, your annual inspections, a good procedure to prepare your annual inspections would save you lots of time afterwards and makes your operational procedure way, way, way smoother. That's what we all want, right? We want safety and fun, and I would like to ride a ride and have the really feeling, okay, the guy who pushes the button and gets me on the track knows what he does. That's it's important information for us, which we again ask you. I say this again and again in a regular annual inspection. It's not even a approval inspection, it's a regular annual inspection where we have to have those documentations available and we'll ask you for it. Nevertheless, this is our accreditation here in the Middle East in Dubai. We try to implement the highest level of safety in the industry. It's sometimes not easy, it's sometimes painful because we have to change things, but each avoided accident is worth it, I think. So as a piece, in preparation of your next inspection, go through your procedures, go your documentation and check whether you, for your own feeling, whether you would be able to fulfill this currently, and if not, please work on this. If you have any questions, feel free to take the phone and ask questions. We don't charge for questions. You get the answer. But because it helps us as well, that when we go in and see a well-prepared situation in the park, it makes our life easier as well. And this is our goal. We want to have a safe and reliable operations for you, and this is our goal, and this is what we do since 8 years, and I think we do this pretty successful, but sometimes painful, because we have to ask you questions which you probably cannot answer right away. But it's in the good of everybody involved in our industry. So if you feel there's something left over, regarding your annual inspections, if you have any questions, if you need information, please feel free to ask. That's what we like, right? So, in our parks, we want to have a smile. We don't want to have to use the emergency kit. That's why we do the same. It's really just regarding safety and well-being of our guests. And that is essentially the content of my little flop here. Please feel free. Please feel free to ask some questions. Nevertheless, here's my email address as well. Let's get a little bit readable. Any questions, any concerns, any topics you want to bring forward? Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Schott. Being the leading company for the installation of water coasters, from our experience, also with TUV South, it's only very reasonable to involve you as early as any possible into a project. So not to involve you in the end when it comes to inspections, but to involve you as early as any possible as a consultant on all these issues you just raised during your presentation. How often is this the case, that you are brought in early enough?
It is mostly not the case.
Yeah. Unfortunately. This is exactly what I'm asking.
Yeah. Unfortunately, mostly not the now before the deal starts. It's so important because you save tons of money by asking the right questions, getting a list of requirements, write this down what you want from your supplier or manufacturer. It saves you tons of money to invest upfront a little bit more money. And it saves you time and it gives you a safe ride. When I get a from Google Translator translated risk assessment and I cannot even read it and I cannot understand it because just Google Translator did it, this is not sufficient documentation of an amusement ride. And before you go in a deal and buy stuff, ask your supplier to deliver this. This is an important task. Good technical documentation for the initial approval process, especially, right? You need to have good structural calculations. You need to have good structural drawings. But besides all the engineering documentation, you have to have a good operations manual in place. You have to have a good specification in place. You have to have a risk assessment in place. And if you ask this afterwards, after you signed your contract, you're often asking a question, don't get an answer. You're hunting for weeks and months those materials. So as a, do yourself a favor and make yourself a list what you need to ask for questions before you go out in the field, go on the deal show and buy materials and buy equipment. Material certificates. When you buy a soft playground, please ask your supplier for a flammability certificate and a HIC certificate and the operations manual and the risk assessment. Five things, ask those five things and you have probably from 100 suppliers, 20 left over.
Does the TUV recommend any companies in that sense? Are you pro?
Next, we have two speakers coming up here at the same time, both from Landmark. Does this work at all?
Hello.
Can I just speak loud?
Yeah, go ahead.
As said, we have two speakers, both from Landmark Leisure, Gavin Fisher and Aditi Sharma. Gavin is joined Landmark Leisure 5 years ago, and he heads the operations across the region. He's a versatile leader with high performance track record on profitable management and business development in various environments. Gavin uses his previous experience from the Compass Group and Alizzi Group to get some exceptional operational status. And Adita Sharma, Adita manages the most important asset for the Landmark Leisure, which of course is the people, a highly resourceful, personable, and hands-on leader who is adaptable to different cultures and provides as a catalyst for change. Aditi brings compassion for people from her previous experience with organizations like Alphatine, GE Money, and American Express. And the topic they will be speaking on.
Go to your coffee break, guys. We're scheduled to talk right now. We are here to talk about employee engagement. Our friend Andrea spoke about it briefly this morning. He spoke a lot about employee satisfaction. So he's kind of made our work very easy. We know what we're talking about. I'm really happy that so many organizations are finally talking about employee engagement, employee satisfaction. Thank you. And then we see, okay, this doesn't work, is it? Stay around, guys. I'm okay. So what I said, organizations are investing more time in employee engagement. More time, more effort, more money we store, people talking about surveys to understand what employee engagement is all about. Are my employees happy? And then still, we do all this, we feel 68% of our employees are still disengaged. This is data given by the likes of Gallup, Conferry Hay Group, Great Place to Work. They all talk about Google, and we'll get to know it's 68%. Just a background. What is employee engagement? It is a mutual commitment between an employee and an employer and organization. It's not about just signing in off a letter. It's actually about getting committed, getting engaged, promising yes, you'll be there, you'll give your best when the employer gives you their best. We all know about employee engagement. We spoke about it this morning, and then we have a small video. What do we do? What can I do? What can you do? What can we do to get our people engaged? It says you have a good leader, you have a great culture, you have good teams, but still if your people are engaged, what do we do for our team? Gavin and I are not engagement gurus. We're not going to come and tell you, oh, do this, it'll work. We're just going to tell you what we do in our organization, what we feel is the right engagement tool to get our people motivated and keeping buying. So just the agenda for this presentation is actually about what really drives employee engagement. Is it just about the money? What are the various drivers of engagement? And then landmark measure. All of us, how we keep our people engaged when they start their career with us, and when they grow with us, and we continue to care for them while they are with us. So I'm gonna pass it on to Gavin.
Thank you. So, first question is it all about the money? So of course, money is extremely important. You know, it's why we go to work, it's what pays our rent, pays school fees, puts food on the table. So it is obviously very significant. But as an engagement tool, does it engage? Well, money is obviously, when you recruit, is an enticement tool. If you're paying more than your competitors, then obviously people can be enticed to come and work for you. Right? And also different compensations, bonuses, paying school fees in this particular region, housing, etc. Again, is a great enticement. Right? But does it help build and motivate people to achieve company goals? Does it help them drive? Well, yes, it does when they first start. You know, they get the paycheck, they get excited, they get paid more than anybody else. Furthermore, you know, people don't necessarily see now, when they start a career, maybe like my grandfather did or my father, that's a career for life, that they'll stay in that job and they'll continue there, right? You know, increasing your salary year after year is obviously part of your growth. It makes you more marketable to go, and is a sign of your performance when moving to another company. So money is extremely important. It's the hook that gets you joining the company, and it also helps maintain your livelihood and makes you want to stay. However, right, money is not the be all and end all, particularly regarding engagement. Right? It's basically is a motivator. It's not a prime mover. And what we mean by that is that simply once you pay people, you'll get them engaged, right? If you pay people the wrong package, your competitors, they'll become very much disengaged, right? But even when you give someone a big pay rise or a big bonus, it only gives them what we call a small bump. It'll only maintain their engagement for a small period of time, right? Particularly if they're working in the business where there may be turmoil, they don't not engage with the boss, they don't get on with the boss, you don't feel the company's values. It will only give them a small bump. So it isn't necessarily all about the money. So what I want to talk about now is the drivers of engagement and what we see as in the business. So we look at where your career starts. When you start with us within Landmark Vision, as you grow with us, the different areas that can engage people, and also how we care for people. So we have a long day work for us, how we look after the staff, all our team members within our business. But what we need to do as well is, money is a hygiene, you need to get that right, but also what else do you need to get right before you start on that journey when somebody starts? You need to have an organising image. The employees feel that their company is composed of how others see the business. When people outside your business see your business as positive, then your staff will automatically see you and be more engaged and see your business as being a positive business to go and work for. Brand alignment, right, ensures that people know and understand what the organisation is about. Right? That they then, if they know what the purpose, what the brand is, they're more likely to do everything they can whenever they want to drive and help that business forward. Culture is obviously key. Right? Organisations create a culture that shows gives meaningful work, will also give deep employment engagement from their teams as well. The clear job roles, people understand exactly what their role is, how to achieve it, how to deliver it, will be more engaged. If they don't understand their role and are unsure, they'll be less positive about achieving, less confident. Right? So having clear job roles that people can then drive forward, engage, and commit to and challenge themselves with. Another one is values and mission, right? It's really important that each person that you work for understands what that company's values are and what their vision. Their vision is exactly is that company's strategy, how they're going to drive that business forward, develop as a business, which also develops the teams as well, right? And a value and vision will give, you know, your team members a purpose, right? So I'm just going to show you a little video now, which hopefully captures what a purpose is.
Now I'm going to tell you a story, and it's an old story, but I find it's a true story if I'm doing some research, but it illustrates the power of purpose. Christopher Wren is known in England as one of the greatest architects in history. Now, originally he wanted to be an astronomer and a philosopher, but he was pulled in the 17th century, kicking and screaming, into the world of being an architect and commissioned to build St. Paul's Cathedral after the Great Fire of 1666, which leveled London. He was a guy that liked brick. He required a lot of bricklayers, and his business was about motivation. One day, in 1671, he observed three of his bricklayers on a scaffold. One crouched, one half standing, and one working very hard and fast. To the first, the crouched, he asked a question, "What are you doing?" Typically, that person without looking up said, "I'm making a living." The second person he asked the same question, "What are you doing?" To which the second bricklayer said, "I'm building a wall." But the third bricklayer, the future leader of that group, the most productive of the three, when asked the question, "What are you doing?" with a gleam in his eye says, "I'm building a cathedral for the Almighty." And it tells a story that's been told for over 300 years, that the most productive person is a person with purpose.
So hopefully, you know, we've gone through there is what we I describe and we describe as hygiene. You know, it's putting things in place to get things right to start that engagement process. So at Landmark Leisure, you know, we see that our first point of engagement is actually the recruitment. So our selection, you know, of approaches is not just making, you know, we have that choice, you know, it's all about us. You know, someone comes for a job interview, we decide whether, you know, they have a job or not. What we want to do is to make sure, so they're fully engaged, that they choose us as well, that they really want to them to come and work for us. They see us as the choice employer. When we go out in the recruitment, we know people have many choices to go and choose, right? And we want to make sure that our recruitment process makes sure that they choose us, right? And they pick us as their career path. So when we start our recruitment process, we don't do straight away interviews. We don't sit down and look at people's CVs, right? We leave that right to the end of the day. We'll probably spend 4 to 5, maybe longer, engaging with anybody that comes to wants to join us. Different activities, different processes that's aimed at delivering and seeing what the behaviours that match our vision and our values within our business. We always say that we don't necessarily always recruit for skill. What we recruit is primarily for the right attitude. So as I say, we'll spend 4 to 5 hours with each of the team members. And what we're looking for is our little made-up word of engageability. We want them to be engaged with us, our values and our culture. We know that we are 80% of the way. People that come and want to work for us are engaged in what we do, have a feeling for our business, show the right behaviours, then we know we have a great potential applicant that's going to come and want to join us. So, after obviously the recruitment, right, what we look at is we make sure that our communication, right, continues to flow throughout our business. From top to bottom, from bottom to top. We make sure that we are effective in communicating to make sure our staff know everything, good or bad, about our business, how we're performing, what we're doing, when we're changing, that they don't get any surprises. Leadership. We feel as leaders that we make sure that we listen to our employees, that we take feedback. We put a lot of emphasis on one of the listening campaigns, which is our employment engagement survey, which we continue to carry out every year. We have done for the last 6-7 years, around November, December time. Right. Performance management serves a platform that comes to line the actions and behaviours to meet the company goals, as well as measuring our employees' progress. So we look at performance continually, day in, week out, and we have tools and measures in place to monitor performance so we can correct it, okay, and then drive and improve performance. We take appraisal and making sure that the process of appraisal, right, is really at the forefront of our business. We actually have a tool in place which actually assesses and gets the team members every single month to give feedback on what they've done well, how they can improve, and effectively a self-assessment appraisal every month, which our managers and team leaders within our store will then give positive feedback and encouragement. That really helps as a tool to drive them to increase their performances, challenge them, and obviously to engage them within the business further. Career development. We take career development, you know, very seriously. You always, when we recruit, say to everyone that's, you know, our frontline teams that we don't actually recruit the next level, which is team leaders for us. All our team leaders across every single store have come from CSRs. So when the people join us, they know that they have the opportunity to grow within our business. And again, that acts as a great engagement tool for making people want to join us and stay with us, because they know, as well as part of that career development, they'll get the training the right training to move forward within business. So final stage.